Guys, so to start again, my name is Kuber, and nice to meet you all guys, and nice of you to have taken the time to come and watch this rather very repeated but again an interesting subject. So what are we going to talk about? We're going to talk about today about proof of funds. Proof of funds for your PR application, whether it is provincial nominee applications or whether it's express entry application. The reason why I'm doing it today again is because very recently, I mean, we hadn't seen that at all, but suddenly there is a deluge of, you know, ADRs, that is additional document requests, and PFLs, which is procedural fairness letters. These have all started coming in big numbers, and some of them are pretty concerning as well. Some of them are very, you know, sort of freaks you out. So we're going to talk about all of them and as to why they're happening, what you can do to avoid, what you should be doing in the first place so that you don't get one at all and that your application goes through smoothly. So let's take it from the top. What exactly is proof of funds? So there is something called LICO, which I'm sure a lot of you know, which is low income cutoff. This is the amount that is decided by Canadian government, by CIC, as an amount that a person would require for his bare necessities, daily living, etc., etc. So each year this amount is changed based on the current cost of living. 50% of this is then agreed or is decided as the amount that will be required by the new immigrants to come to Canada and have this funds available with them so that they can make a smooth transition into their new lives in Canada. Canadian government is not going to provide you any financial support. I mean, come on, they're already giving you a PR, right? It's a great opportunity. Why would anybody expect them to sort of bear the bill as well or foot the bill as well? So yeah, they're not going to give you any financial support. They're giving you lots of other support by ways of different facilities. So money is not going to be one of that. So but they expect you to have this money so that, you know, you can make this smooth transition into your new life in Canada. Therefore you need this money. The law that talks about this is Immigration Refugee Protection Regulation, Section 76, subsection B, subsection 1. And it says, a skilled worker must have, in the form of transferable and available funds, unencumbered by debts or other obligations, an amount equal to one half of the minimum necessary income applicable in respect of the group of persons consisting of the skilled worker and their family members. Now, what this means is, regardless of the fact of whether your spouse is accompanying you in your application, or regardless of the fact if your dependent children are accompanying in the application, you still need to provide proof of funds for your entire family size. Now, mind you, for the sake of PR application, the family basically means your spouse, common law partner, and dependent children. And dependent children as of today is under the age of 22 years. So if your family is, let's say, husband, wife, or, you know, common law partners or whatever, and children, so let's say the family size is 4, then you need to provide funds for 4. If the family size is 2, then you provide for 2. If you're only one single individual, then you provide for one person. You will get the updated required amount of proof of funds on the CIC website. One person, I think, is $12,475 Canadian. 2 is 15,000 something, 3 is 19,093 or something. But always check the CIC website for the updated proof of funds amount so that you don't go wrong there. So that's the first thing out of the way, the regulation which defines this requirement. Now, the second bit is what exactly is proof of funds. So we've done the legal and technical, and so what basically is proof of funds? The money should be available to you. It should be unencumbered. It should be free of any lines or any debts or any loans. This is the requirement, that it should be available to you. Now, when we say available to you means cash in a bank. I mean, cash not as in hard cash, because it's very difficult to prove hard cash in hand, as in how will you show it in your application. I mean, you're not going to take photocopies of your cash available. So money in the bank is the best and the safest way to show proof of funds. If at all, for whatever reason, money in account is not what you have funds as, then any other source of money, funds that you have, which are encashable or which can be liquidated on demand and on the face value, those can be used as proof of funds. So this is like a rule of thumb. Any kind of funds that you have in any form, which can be encashed on demand and on the face value, you can use them as proof of funds. Jewelry, no. Assets, no. Real estate, no. You cannot show the value of any kind of assets as proof of funds. As I said, the law very clearly states that this money should be readily available to you. So this is the basic fundamental of proof of funds. No rocket science. We have gone through this plenty of times. Now, what do you need to prove that these funds are available to you? Okay, as far as IRCC is concerned, for proof, you must get official, quote unquote, official letters from any bank or financial institutions where you are holding your money. So the key word here is official. Don't just grab a online bank statement. That is not an official letter. When we say official, it basically means, and they've described that, the letters must be printed on the financial institution's letterhead. There it goes, very clear. It must include their contact information, address, telephone number, and email address. This letter must include your name. It must list your outstanding debts, such as credit card debts and loans. Include for each current bank and investment account. It should include your account numbers, the date each account was opened, the current balance of each account, the average balance for the past 6 months. So basically the letter should also include monthly average balance for the last 6 months. And this by itself is the complete document which states your proof of funds. So if you can provide this, voila, perfect. But we know, you know, the banks are not the most flexible when they want to give you these letters, and in most cases getting such letters is a bit of a pain. So what do you do? Under any circumstance, you should still be able to get a letter. Okay, any bank that you're holding your account with, they should be able to provide you a letter which they call as account letter or account details or balance letter or a current balance letter, whatever you want to call it. So this letter will basically be on their letterhead, ideally. It will list your account number, it will list your name, it will mention your name. It must mention your account opening date, or at least how long you've been banking with them. It must mention your current available balance. This will work, okay? But in addition to that, you must also provide last 6 months official bank statement. Now, when I say official bank statement, I mean, don't just take one as a printout from your online account. Don't do that. Nowhere does it say you can't do that, but since they specify again and again on official, and I have seen one case where somebody actually contested in the federal court that they did provide documents, but they were all online statements, and federal court upheld the judgment or decision of IRCC to refuse that application because the documents were not official. So with official in context here, provide an official bank letter on the letterhead, provide bank statements, official bank statements, which are either on the original letterhead of the bank, or at least the one where bank has put a stamp or a seal, which makes them official. So this is in case where you have had the funds for quite some period of time, the funds are available to you, they're in their account, and all's well here. The next very frequently asked question is, do I need to maintain the funds for the last 6 months, or what is the period of time that you need to maintain funds, or I don't have the funds for 6 months, etc., 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 etc. Nowhere in immigration law or nowhere on the CIC website or nowhere in any of the ministerial instructions that govern the express entry or PR application process does it state that the funds must be available to you for the last 6 months, or rather it doesn't mention any period as such. So what's this thing with 6 months, or why is it there? The reason why it's there is because the law does mention that the funds must be unencumbered and they must be free of any lines or any they're not as a loan. In order to check if these funds were available to you, are available to you, have been yours or belong to you, CIC likes to check your funds for the last 6 months. And within the last 6 months, if the funds have been available to you or they have progressively increased in your account and you can prove where the money has been coming from, there is no requirement for age of these funds. Okay, so this is absolutely fine. But let's say and it applies to a lot of you out there, you don't have the money in your account, but you have great friends, relatives, parents, etc., and who are willing to gift you this money. A very important, gift you the money. It's not a loan. So they don't want it back. So they will gift you this money, and they will give you this gift out of love and affection. And that is absolutely fine. Even if this money was deposited in your account on the day that you file your application, it's absolutely fine, as long as you can prove where the money came from. In this case, you're going to prove that the money was gifted to you by your parent, by your sibling, by your relative, by your friend, by whosoever. Because gift, or money being received as gift, has not been mentioned or has not been contested by CIC, we accept that this is accepted. So how would you prove this money has been received as gift? You will prove this money has been received as gift by form of a gift deed. Now, what's a gift deed? Again, a lot of confusions, a lot of stories, a lot of contesting thoughts about gift deed. Some people say it will be taxed in the home country. You are not registering this gift deed with your tax authorities in your country. Guys, gift deed is a simple document on an official piece of paper. An official piece of paper, I would mean a stamp paper for some countries, or a notarized affidavit, or a document prepared by a lawyer. All these are fine. So it's an official document which basically states, it's like a sworn affidavit, it's like a sworn statement made by the donor, stating that out of love and affection I'm giving this money to my friend, brother, sister, son, whatever relation that might be. And I'm giving it out of love and affection, that this money is out of my savings and I don't want this money back. And this person is free to use this money as this person sees fit. This is your gift deed. This need not be registered with any tax authority, and hence there is no tax payable on this document. This document is primarily and only and specifically for the purpose of your PR application. It has no other purpose. That's all this gift deed does, and all it proves is that this money has been received to you by gift. So let's say today is the day you're going to submit your application. You didn't have the money all this while. Your accounts have been, let's say, zero. And today you've received $12,475, all deposited in your account. Now you get a gift deed proving this money has come to you as a gift. Ideally, get a check, take a copy of the check, add that as part of your documents. If it's an online transfer, provide the transaction history, which shows that this was transferred from whoever is giving you the money. Try to make the visa officer's life easy. The more easy you make for them, the faster your application goes through. The less headache, the less review required, kind of notes you will see in your GCMS notes. Make it easy for them. Understand what they need. Understand why they need it. And then if you can provide it to them, your application will go through smoothly. They need to see funds available to you. Provide it to them. They need to see funds that are not a loan, that they do not have any lines attached to it. Provide it to them, and it makes your life very, very easy. So one of the most frequently used processes is gift deed, and I've already gone through that. Talk document must also mention if you have any loans, if you have any debts, if you have any consumer loans, credit cards, etc., etc., because this is a clear requirement. Okay. So if your bank statement is going to show a monthly installment going out for your home loan, car loan, personal loan, credit card, etc., 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 but you do not mention anything in terms of your debt, it's going to raise a question. So please do provide the details of your debt. Okay. Ideally in the form of a letter from the bank, which shows what your liability is. If you cannot provide that, provide a credit card statement, provide a home loan statement or whatever you have. You see, again, coming back to the fundamental, what does CIC want to do with these documents? All they want to make sure is that this money is available to you. That's it. You know, this money is yours, this money is available to you, and you can, you know, it's available to you in the form which you can liquidate or in cash immediately, and that's all that they require from you. Make it easy for them. If you have any debt, usually the loans against assets, for example, home loan, car loan, these loans are not an issue. Okay. I know there have been some additional document requests, even some PFLs, which have raised a question mark on the debt and on the loan. But you see, when they raise question marks is when you have not provided sufficient information. They raise those question marks when you have not provided the details that you should have in the first place. So don't just give them a set of documents and let them understand and let them, you know, getting around to realize what it means. Use your letter of explanation very well to explain what your funds are all about. If you have loans, mention it. If you have got a gift, mention it. Explain it, guys. If you leave it for them to interpret it, then you know you're putting yourself in a risk, at a risk, for the reason because they might interpret it in any which ways they want. So if you explain it, it makes it easier for them, easier for you. So coming back to the debts and loans, debts, as I said, against assets is usually not an issue as long as you've explained it. Consumer debts, credit cards, personal loans, educational loans, etc., etc., also need mentioning specifically if they are already reflecting in your account. If they are not reflecting in your account, I'm not going to tell you whether you should show it or not. CIC says you must. I know a lot of people who haven't showed it and they're absolutely fine. Then there are some people who did not show it and got caught out because it was mentioned somewhere. So you can take a call. It's a judgment call. Guys, you have to do it yourself. CIC wants you to list it. If it reflects in your accounts, you definitely must mention it. If not, then it's your call. But in your letter of explanation, I would also like you to explain your debt settlement plan. That goes a long way in making sure CIC understands how these funds are going to be available to you. For example, the requirement of funds is $12,475, but your documents show that you have a loan of $20,000. Obviously, CIC is going to wonder, how are these funds going to be available to you when you actually have a loan? So let's say they process your application in 3 months or 6 months time, and you are actually coming to Canada with a loan of $20,000. Then how much funds are actually available to you, you know, to sort of settle in? So in such cases, I would strongly recommend that you provide a repayment plan to CIC, as in mentioned to CIC, stating that these are your loans, this is what you make, this is your income, this is how you earn your salary, this is how you've been paying thus far, and this is how you plan to clear, and you know, use your letter of explanation in the best way possible. If you have any debts, if you have any loans, please mention it. If these are loans against assets, by all means say that if you will leave your home country, you intend to settle your loans by selling off or disposing your assets. Or if you have consumer debt, then please provide a payment plan so that CIC understands how the funds that you are showing are available to you. So this is all about debt and loan. Now, some people have asked if shares and bonds and debentures, etc. are acceptable. No, they are not acceptable because shares, bonds, mutual funds, all these are subject to market risk. So they are always not going to be considered at face value. The minute they're not considered at face value, they put your proof of funds at risk. The officer could then again ask for review, and then again it gets parked, gets processed, as in gets into the processing delay, because someone has to now make a call whether they will accept it or not. In most cases, they will ask you to sort of provide something else. Definitely possessions, real estate, etc., etc., are not acceptable. Bitcoins, cryptocurrency, again, because there is no clear legislation on this cryptocurrency, they cannot be accepted as proof of funds. Now, funds can be held jointly with your spouse, and that's absolutely fine. Funds can also be in your spouse's name, and that is also fine, provided your spouse is accompanying you in your application. So if your spouse is accompanying in your application, funds in the spouse's name is absolutely fine and acceptable. Joint account, absolutely acceptable. The only additional document you will need is a consent letter from the spouse, plain paper, plain piece of paper, you know, addressed to IRCC, from the spouse, stating that my account number so-and-so, available balance so-and-so is available to my spouse so that he can use it at his free will without any obligation. I have no objection to this, and this letter is just absolutely fine, no issues there, but it's required. If you have joint accounts with anybody else, then it's always an issue, because then those funds are not available to you entirely, you know, you because they are jointly held by a third party. When I say third party, I mean parents, I could mean could be relatives, could be friends, I do not know who you have a joint account with, but when they are not in your name, then it's always an issue. Funds cannot be in your children's name. So if you have a children's savings account, those cannot be used as proof of funds. They must be in your name, your spouse's name, or jointly held with your spouse. If you have a joint account with your parent, it's not an ideal situation. I personally would ask you to move it to your name or remove your parent from your joint account. But if you cannot do that, and if you really, really, really must go this way, then provide an affidavit from your parents stating that the parent has no objection in you using the entire amount of funds for your, you know, whatever you need it for. Provide that. Not recommended, but if that's the only way you have to go, then please, by all means. Provident funds. I know a lot of people have already posted in our on the comment as well. So provident fund, how does that apply? Now, in some countries, it's called provident fund. In some countries, it's called pension fund. In some countries, it's called EPF, which is employee provident fund, etc., etc. Different names. But what provident funds are, these are the funds which are used, or are not used basically, are deducted by your employer and held in a government fund, certain percentage. And they are available to you after you either retire or if you... you know, leave your job. I think that's what it basically is. Yes, they can be used. To cut a long story short, yes, you can use provident funds as your proof of fund, provided you provide an official letter from the financial institution who is holding your funds. And the letter must clearly state that these funds are available to you without any conditions. So if the letter states any conditions, then it's not a good thing. So people who want to use provident funds, just printing a statement from your online account is not a good idea. Get an official one from whichever is the nearest provident fund office that you who's holding your account, who's holding your funds. Get a letter from them, get a passbook, get a official bank official statements from them as to what are the available funds and what are, if there are any terms or if there are any conditions in your releasing these funds. Very important document. I know of some people who've had their applications refused because they just took an online statement. It's a discretionary thing, you know. Sometimes they will accept it, sometimes they will not accept it. As far as I'm concerned, I will always ask you to tread on the safe way, because you do not know which day who is going to apply the law in which fashion. So please, if you're using proof of funds, provident funds as your proof, pension plan funds for your proof of funds, please provide official document from the authority who is holding your funds. It could also be your employer. So if it's an employer or a trust by an employer, please provide an official letter from these authorities or these organizations or these institutions stating the available balance, amount, if they have any conditions. Another frequently asked question is about life insurance policies, if you can use them. Well, you cannot use the policy value as proof of funds, of course not. What you can use is unconditional surrender value of your life insurance policy. Again, it's discretionary. It's on discretion of the visa officer how they interpret your life insurance policy's surrender value. So a clear document from the insurance policy company stating what is the surrender value and if there are any conditions attached to it, you may use that as well. However, certain provinces have an issue with the age of funds, and the biggest one, obviously, I'm sure most of you know, is Saskatchewan. Saskatchewan has a very specific requirement that the funds must be available to you for the last 3 months at the time of your application. So you file an expression of interest, you receive an ITA, ITA gives you time to apply, and you do not have sufficient time. It's a very tricky one. SINP, Saskatchewan, categorically does not accept gift deeds. They will not accept funds which are less than 6 months. Your call if you want to go ahead with your application or not. If you need any clarity, please write to Saskatchewan Immigration Department. The email address is immigration@gov.sk.ca. Feel free to write to them and ask for any clarifications you want on Saskatchewan proof of funds. They actually accept mutual funds, bonds, treasury bonds, shares, all these as proof of funds, as long as they have been held by you for at least last 3 months. Very clear with that. They do not accept gift deeds. Other provinces may not accept gift deeds. It's absolutely discretionary. There is no clear mandate on gift deeds as such. Gift deed is just a document which we use to show where the money has come from. So if you need any clarity as far as a particular province is concerned, I would suggest write to them, because as I said, there is no clear mandate. So always a discretion of the visa officer will apply. Another document which is very, very commonly used is fixed deposits. A lot of people recommend it. Even I recommend it. I mean, fixed deposit is a great thing, because the reason why fixed deposits are a great thing is because, one, it is earning you some interest, of course. Second is because it's fixed, you know, available funds. They can be encashed on demand. When you are using fixed deposits for proof of funds, use the principal value. Please do not use the maturity value, because you do not know when you're going to withdraw them. So please use the principal value, and those are absolutely acceptable and good to use. Again, the age matters. The reason for that is because CIC would want to know where to get the money for these fixed deposits. So if you've made them recent, if you've recently made a fixed deposit, please provide proof of funds. Please provide source of these funds. It makes your application gets processed easily, makes the life of the visa officer easy, and it just goes to sort of makes it easier for the whole process. Proof of funds at the time of your first landing in Canada. I'm not sure how many of you are watching who've already got your PPRs, but it's a small topic on the subject. We'll take this as well. As per the law is concerned, they require you to have proof of funds at the time of your application and at the time when they approve it. Now, the approval happens when you land in Canada, because you're not a permanent resident unless you have landed and signed your COPR in the presence of the border officer. Commonly, they don't ask you for proof of funds, but that doesn't mean they will never ask you for proof of funds or they don't ask for it at all. There are a lot of people who have been asked for proof of funds, but when you land in Canada, age of funds is irrelevant. All they need to know and see is that you have these funds available with you. So either you can have them in cash, you can have them in bank drafts, traveler's checks, forex cards, or you can also provide them with an updated bank statement to show that the money is available to you and that you've arrived in Canada. Now you want to open an account in Canada and you will transfer these funds. All these are absolutely acceptable. Yes, but please be prepared to show proof of funds if and when you're landing in Canada, because they will ask for it. Now, I do have a confirmation from New Delhi Visa Office with regards to proof of funds at the time of landing, and they replied that acceptable proof of funds are bank accounts in your name or in the name of your accompanying spouse, common law partner, cashable investments in your name or accompanying spouse, common law partner, cashable fixed deposits, also acceptable. What is not acceptable is bank accounts in somebody else's name, bank account in a joint name with somebody else, bank accounts in the name of spouse who is not accompanying you to Canada, property, jewelry, vehicle valuations. So all this will not be accepted. So all this are acceptable proof of funds at the time of your landing. Okay. And this has also been a very contested debate as to when is the proof of funds assessed. In most cases, people, when they provide their proof of funds, it's in the local currency. So if you're in India, Indian rupees, Pakistan, Pakistani rupees, Bangladeshi taka, Nepali rupees, or wherever, whichever part of the world you are in. In most cases, the bank may or may not give you in writing the equivalent Canadian currency or Canadian amount for your funds available. I have always believed and have always checked through hundreds and hundreds of GCMS nodes that CIC will assess your proof of funds on the day they assess your proof of funds. On the day they run your A11.2 assessment checks, and once they come to your proof of funds, on that particular day, the applicable exchange rate will be applied. That's what I strongly believe. I have good reason to believe. Provided a lot of proof on posts. I have provided a lot of GCMS notes to show that CIC is actually checking for proof of funds on the day they assess the documents. They do not lock your exchange rate on AOR. From the various GCMS notes, and trust me, there are a lot of them available. You can also check on the GCMS notes on our groups. You will realize that the assessment of exchange rate is on the day that they choose to pick up your file, pick up your documents, and say, okay, let's check what your proof of funds are. On that day, they will check the current applicable exchange rate and apply those. If your funds, due to exchange rate fluctuations, drop below the required amount, so for example, the requirement, requ sorry. The required amount is 12,475. Exchange rate has plummeted, and now your funds available are equal to only 11,500. It's a problem. The reason for that is because, though a lot of people are saying that because the exchange rate drops, it's not your problem, it is your problem, guys, because as per the law, you are expected to have the funds which are applicable to your family size, and they should be available to you for your movement to the country. Now that you're providing the funds, they have dropped below the required amount. It's an issue. What can be done? Well, what happens in such cases is that first of all, this thing goes for review required. Most of you know that in GCMS notes, if settlement funds shows review required, then it's a bit of a. What happens is then it gets parked. It gets parked. It gets put in a queue. For the case officer to now review it, check, and make a decision. If the required funds have reduced or dropped by a few dollars, the chances are they will let it pass because they understand at the day that you must have submitted, the funds were available. Now that they've dropped, it's you know, dropped below the requirement. In some cases, they will ask you for updated proof of funds. If you ordered GCMS notes, and if you have checked what the case officer's notes are, and it states that there is a review required, don't always jump the gun and send them a CSE or a web form and upload your proof of funds. Check what, how much has it been, how much has, sorry, how much has it dropped by? I mean, if it's few dollars, don't stress too much about it. Yes, it will take a bit of time, but it will get through. But if it is substantial drop, and which is the case in a lot of applications, do provide updated proof of funds proactively. What that will do is it will, you know, so they don't have to send you an ADR, they don't have to ask you for updated proof of funds. They will get it, they will check, yes, everything's fine, and that review which was required will then, you know, get processed and it will move on. But in order to avoid this, I would say please do not play with that fine line, or you know, if the requirement is 12,475, don't just go with that figure. It's your money, nobody's taking it from you. Provide extra. The money is still going to remain in your account, it's your money. So if the exchange rate, for example, is X, provide X plus 10, or provide X plus 100, provide X plus 1000 if you can. As I said, this is your money. It will remain in your account. So provide extra, considering what the exchange rates might be in the few days to come. The money stays in your account. So as I'm saying again, make the visa officer's life easy, and in turn your application will go through easily. If you haven't found your answer, please see this video again. I'm sure you will find your answers in some point of time. If there are still any questions which you think I was not able to address, please come back to our Facebook group, which basically deals with only express entry and related, and feel free to post it on the group, and I'll be very happy to take a look at it. Not only me, I mean there are plenty of great awesome members that we have who also like to share experiences, not to mention our awesome team of moderators who are always available and work selflessly to answer your queries. Guys, thank you so much. I really appreciate your having joined us today. You are what makes me keep coming back every week to do this. Thank you so much. Remember me in your prayers, and I will see you again very soon. Bye-bye.